to Heroes Forge, a Heroes of the Storm podcast.
What's going on, Forgers? Welcome to episode number 48 of Heroes Forge, a community-driven podcast all about Heroes of the Storm. This is your show host, as always, Jeff Reynolds, and I'm always joined here by the co-host of the show, Kristen Ashton, who is more awesome than Thanksgiving leftovers. What's going on, Kristen?
Finishing up those leftovers and feeling deliciously stuffed. How about you, Jeff? You have a lot of Thanksgiving leftovers?
Oh, yeah. Tons of leftovers. And they just, I feel like they never start tasting bad to me. I can have them every single day. And it just feels like a holiday every single day as you go through the week. It's phenomenal.
It's very true. And it makes me wonder if the foods that have become Thanksgiving staples weren't chosen because of their ability to be reheated and still taste just as good as the day they were eaten.
That is the best theory I have ever heard ever. I mean, they're thinking of the sequels before they bring out the main film here, right?
Exactly. And families have done Thanksgiving long enough that it's secrets that are passed down from generation to generation. Mashed potatoes are good. Corn is good. Turkey is great, especially with turkey sandwiches, cranberry, and green bean casserole.
Mm-hmm. Can't forget the green bean casserole. Tons of great Thanksgiving stuff going on. And to all of our listeners out there who celebrate Thanksgiving, happy Thanksgiving from Heroes Forge. Hope you had a fantastic one. And we have sort of a themed forging this week for Thanksgiving in a way. But we'll get to that in just a few because we got to talk about something that was really cool that happened, Kristen.
We did. This past weekend, Kyle Ferguson was kind enough to bring Jeff and myself onto his Saturday Team League stream where we got to play with him, Bo Schwartz, and John Jagger. And we had a fantastic run. We ended up going, 6-2 victories?
Yeah, we did pretty well considering the fact, I mean, you guys are all really great Heroes players, and I'm not so bad myself, but when we're playing this game together, and you know, Kristen, one thing that was really cool about it that I had never experienced before is that we had a literal shot caller in Kyle in the game. I mean, we were on voice chat streaming over Twitch. It was really cool. The adrenaline was pumping. I held my breath for like 25 minutes at a time during each game and had to gasp at the end of all of them because I was so focused on what's going on, and Kyle has such a great ability to be that shot caller, and that's something that you don't get in the leagues that I play in down at the, you know, the silver or the gold leagues even, where you have these people that are calling the shots and everyone else is actually listening to what's going on.
Exactly. No one's fighting back. There are occasions where there are ideas being thrown around, little discussions being had when there's downtime as to what to do, but all in all, there is a team captain, basically, and if everyone is on board, chances are it should go well.
Yeah, especially with a team captain like Kyle, and then everybody on the team was just really, really fun, and it was cool to see the drafting strategies, and of course, the drafting strategies are different in, you know, Kyle's league, Diamond, all the way down to where I'm playing in the Silver, so we had to talk it out, and it was just a total blast, and he's putting it up on a VOD, correct?
Correct. That is uploading this evening, so it should be up by tomorrow.
Yeah, it's something to check out because it was fun nonetheless. I mean, out of everything, there are some really cool moments where some clutch stuff happens at the last second. Check it out. It was a lot of fun, and a huge thank you to Kyle for having us on the show. It was a huge learning experience, and the chat was really great too. So thank you all. And just in the Thanksgiving spirit and the getting into the gift-giving spirit and the Black Friday spirit, Blizzard games are on sale in Battle.net.
They are sales all over the place, but that's gearing up for Cyber Monday, isn't it? Because it was just Black Friday. But then the internet came around, and suddenly there's Cyber Monday.
More excuses to not work when you're at work and buy things online instead of doing what it is you're supposed to be doing. They've got some really great sales. I mean, Overwatch is probably one of the best sales out there to pick up that game. Some WoW sales, some StarCraft sales, and then, of course, in Heroes, the game we talk about here, skins are on sale. All the legendary skins are on sale. You can go in there and buy some bundles. You can get some great stuff. And I found that because I own some of the heroes, or most of them, in some of those bundles, I was able to pick up some characters like Lili for 62 cents.
it's amazing that they do that, right? Because it wouldn't seem like a practice that many companies do, where if you own something that's part of it already, it reduces the price. But I love that they do that so that you're not paying double for something you already own, but yet you can still take advantage of something that has caught your eye.
Yeah, and Lili caught my eye there because, I mean, I've been hearing a lot of things about your Lili, Kristen. Your Lili play sounds pretty on point, so I gotta start practicing Lili, too, to get up there.
I think you'll enjoy Lili. She's Morales is a lot of fun to be mean to the enemy team players with. Like, you're the Morales that they just can't kill. It drives people nuts. Lili is very much in that same vein. I think you're going to have a blast with her.
Yeah, because I am definitely in the team league stream on Saturday. I got to play a ton of Morales, which is my main support. So I was playing lots of Morales, and that was fun. So I can't wait to pick up Lili and start to expand my support options as we go through. And then speaking of expanding, Heroes of the Storm is expanding its character list at a huge rate, a hugely fast rate is what I'm trying to say. And Ragnaros is on the horizon. I can tell you the hype personally is building for Ragnaros.
Little by little. I mean, we were excited when Varian released, but I think Ragnaros is going to be just as exciting, if not more, because Ragnaros seems to have an even bigger following, you know? I think Varian had such a great following because Legion pretty much just launched as he came out, so we're all still emotionally scarred from that, and we want him to still be alive in our hearts, so why not alive in Heroes? But Ragnaros. Ragnaros is a fire lord. He shoots down balls of flame. What's not to love?
Absolutely. And you know, the thing is that as you're saying this, I'm realizing, well, Varian is really alliance focused, but Ragnaros was on both sides here. It doesn't matter if you're Horde or Alliance. At one point, you encountered Ragnaros. Maybe multiple times you encountered Ragnaros. So maybe there's a bigger draw for that. Maybe there's a bigger draw because of his kit and the way that he plays and being able to take over towers and things, or not towers, but keeps and forts. I think that's a really cool way to play, and I can't wait to see how the pros implement that into their pro scene at some point, because I have some ideas of how that would work, and I want to see how they think of it.
It will be interesting, and I'm more intrigued when it comes to picking the heroics, which one will be the big one. Do we go with Sulfurous Smash, or do we go with Lava Wave? My money is going to be on Sulfurous Smash.
Oh, really? See, I'm thinking on, like, Braxis Holdout, like, when you've got that's the one with the Zerg Wave, right? That's the one I'm talking about, where the Zerg are pushing. If you take that Lava Wave, you can really do some damage to them.
Oh, that's a great point. Map-specific, or choosing heroics based on the map you're on, Jeff, that's too advanced. You learned a lot on Saturday. But we need to pull it back here.
Yeah, that's right. See, I'm analyzing everything. And one last point about Saturday that was really cool is Kyle's wealth of knowledge is amazing, because we're playing this and he's got all the numbers in his head where he's saying, you know, the tribute's going to spawn in 33 seconds and I respawn here and, you know, my cooldown will be at this point in this seconds and that seconds. And I mean, there's so much to learn from that. Check out that stream. It was a ton of fun. But we're here to talk about Heroes and what Heroes we're forging for the Nexus, so let's forge.
Let's forge.
All right, this week we originally said that we were thinking really outside the box with this hero and to bring your imaginations to this forge, because it may be a little different. We're going to need a bunch of imagination to make this happen. But then Ro from Realm Maintenance said, or is this as inside of the box as it will get? So Kristen, who are we forging this week?
Well, Jeff, I feel like you should introduce him since somebody won this past week and wears the belt of the champion. So, Jeff, I ask you, who are we forging this week?
This week, I think we need to bring it in-house, kind of, so to speak. And I thought we would imagine what the Raven Lord would be like if he was a character, if he had some lore that maybe we came up with and using the lore that's already known about him, and also if he was a character or a hero in Heroes of the Storm. So there's a lot of thinking to do, and there's a lot at stake here, because I am still behind in the community votes. So I'm trying to build as many good kits as I can and use as much imagination as possible, Kristen.
But we just got to get you to build a backstory for every single hero we forge, and you'll take it, no problem.
Well, I'm not that lucky with the Raven Lord, because he has a little bit of story that goes along with his lore already. So, Kristen, why don't you let everybody know what that is?
Will do. Ruler over the Raven Court, the Raven Lord's dominion includes that of Cursed Hollow and Haunted Mines. However, in a bid for more power, he extended his reach outward toward Towers of Doom, where he is currently battling the Gravelord for dominance. A regal, learned, and rather smug individual, he enjoys watching heroes battle on his land in pursuit of victory. Offer enough to him, and he may bestow his blessings upon you.
Well said, and here we go, because this character we've never seen, right?
No, we haven't. There are sketches. You know, we see the raven, the giant raven. He's wearing the necklace, and he's got his claws on skulls, apparently, of his enemies. Maybe they're just skulls he found and wanted to decorate with. But is that actually him? I mean, the way that the guy is talking, I'm assuming he has a human aspect, because the sounds he's making are definitely that of those created by humans with flesh and lips and voice boxes.
Yeah, and so that begs the questions here of which direction we could go with the Raven Lord. And this is so cool. We've talked about this often on the show, where, you know, the League of Explorers is a great example of how Hearthstone wasn't afraid to create its own lore that was kind of focused, not kind of, but directly focused on World of Warcraft, but didn't quite exist in the way that it does in Heroes of the, or in Hearthstone. And they're doing the same sort of thing with this new expansion for Hearthstone coming out, where they're taking the lore and they're kind of expanding on it to make it more in depth and fit that game. So with the Raven Lord and the Gravekeeper on these teams that are fighting against each other, they're not necessarily characters that we know of other than from Heroes of the Storm. So I think it would be really cool if they started bringing these characters to life in these games.
And it sounds like a lot of people would, and you make a great point there, because Blizzard can't help but expand the universe and create little stories within other stories. Nexus brings together characters that aren't supposed to exist in the same universe, right? And here they are battling it out, but yet in the background, even in three lines of text, There are little stories. There is a Raven Lord that watches over two of the maps, and then he's fighting the Gravekeeper in Towers of Doom. So you versus another team are fighting for these gods, these rulers, these unseen powerful beings. You're fighting their battles for them. And it begs the question, should we actually be fighting in the first place? I mean, are we here to help a greater evil?
Yeah, it doesn't sound very kind. I mean, they obviously don't like each other as you're fighting on Towers of Doom. They obviously are fighting for something in these worlds that are pretty dark, right? I mean, the Raven Lord's world is pretty dark, and then the Raven Court, and, you know, going through the whole Haunted Mines aspect and things like that, and his voice is very dark, so you don't really know what and who you're fighting for. So hopefully we can accomplish something here on that front too in our imaginations, and see where it may take us if we put the Raven Lord as a tune in the game that you could actually select and play.
I would love to see him, but like we're saying, will we see him or will we not see him? That's the big question, I think, that's on the minds of everybody.
Yeah, and how would it affect the game if you were to play the Raven Lord and you brought him into Cursed Hollow, right? What would that do to the game? Could it change the way that the game is voiced over? Maybe the Gravekeeper took over Cursed Hollow if the Raven Lord is playing on that battlefield and it's the same map objectives and everything, but it's themed differently? I mean, I don't know. It could go a lot of different places.
That's a fantastic idea. And that would, I think Blizzard would eat that up, because again, that plays to the whole idea that they can't help but add lore to things. They just, it's what they do. And I think that may be why Blizzard games are just so entrancing in a way, is because there's always story there, regardless of how simple that story may be.
Yeah, and people like us that are really into that story, it just keeps us going forward and playing these games and ultimately purchasing things and having fun and hanging out with our friends. And it's a great business model, I'm telling you. Okay, let's get to these builds. If this is your first time listening to Heroes Forge, welcome to the show. The way this works is that we each build a kit for the selected character of the week if they were to come into Heroes of the Storm. And then at the end of the show, you can jump on over to our Twitter page, which is twitter.com/ForgeHeroes, and you can vote on which one of the builds you think took the cake and won the entire thing. All right, Kristen, since I did win and chose the hero, you get the privilege of going first this week. Let's start with the role specialization for the Raven Lord if he was in the game.
Okay, the role, I'm going with specialist, but think kind of medieval specialist. He fills a spot, but not necessarily a lane pushing spot.
Ah, neat. Okay, so kind of in the same respect as if you picked a tank or a bruiser, you're saying it's kind of in that in-between area.
Correct. He's special. That's really the only reason I would put specialist. He's not a healer, not a tank, and certainly not an assassin.
Oh, that fits in specialist in my mind. Let's hear his trait.
All right, the trait is called My Domain. And the Raven Lord rules over every map from on high. He is not a character that appears on the battlefield at any time, helping his allies only from the use of his abilities. In addition, taking structures increases the potency of the Raven Lord's abilities, since, as a ruler, domination is all he asks as tribute.
Oh, so that is pretty special there.
Yep, it was the question I thought long and hard about. Can I put him in there and be happy? And the answer I came across was no. I don't want to see a realized version of the Raven Lord, because I feel he has an image in my own mind, kind of like bringing a book to a movie. Rarely are characters portrayed in a way that you go, oh my goodness, that's exactly how I envision them. A lot of the time, books leave characters rather open-ended in terms of how they were to look, so that your imagination can fill in the gaps and make you that much more connected to them.
Yeah, because I think we all have a vision of what the Raven Lord might look like. I mean, even if you don't consciously think about it or sit down to draw it out, you know, you can picture somebody as they're speaking to you and you're playing this game, unless you're like me and you're just holding your breath the whole time and you barely hear anything. But I'm telling you, this is a really, really cool idea. So the first question that I have, which may get answered later in your build, is how do you mitigate the XP for killing this hero or not killing this hero? And don't answer it if it comes later in your build here, but I'm just thinking that if you take a hero off of the battlefield, it might be difficult to do that.
That's a fantastic question that didn't even come up when I built it. I didn't even consider the potential loss of XP. So in that case, maybe something you could balance out is when your teammates die, they give a little more XP. So in that case, you really punish a team who should be playing more carefully and more wily and playing to the strengths of what this Raven Lord is going to offer, versus a four stack that just runs in and keeps dying because they haven't adjusted their playstyle to fit that of this team member.
Dang, off the cuff, that was such a great idea. Just kind of spread the XP out among the rest of the team. I think that's cool, and you gotta play safer that way if you're gonna play a team with the Raven Lord with your build on it. I think that's great. What were you thinking for his mount? I mean, obviously he's floating over the battlefield. Does he have complete vision?
He would not have complete vision. And so I imagine you would be the Raven Lord. So your screen is basically, you're looking through the eyes of the Raven Lord. So he's not visible anywhere. You can hear him in your headphones, of course. So in that case, there would be no mount. You can scroll your camera across, but you don't necessarily have visibility of the, all of those invisible places.
Okay, cool. So I see what you're saying. So you've just got this RTS top-down view of the battlefield that we all have right now, and you're just able to move the camera normally like we all are right now, but you're able to do things, I would guess, globally, is what you're saying?
Yes.
Ooh, let's hear it. What's your first basic ability?
Okay, first Q is called Lord's Blessing. A single target ability, Lord's Blessing buffs the target hero, giving them bonus movement speed and increased sight, including a brief period of total unobstructed vision.
Oh, that's a really good quote-unquote support ability, too. I mean, you're really supporting from on high, so to speak.
Exactly, and I like to imagine, because you're looking at the battle, I'd want to personally be able to buff somebody who's chasing down somebody who has a sliver of health. And if they had just a little bit more movement, they could reach them and take the kill. So that's kind of what I was hoping for.
Yeah, you have to be on point in this Ravenlord build to be watching map control, where people are, what's going on, so that if somebody is chasing them down, and especially if you were on comms and you could say, I'm chasing down Jaina or whatever, and then the Ravenlord could pop over and then give you a little bit of this Lord's Blessing and let you chase her down.
Exactly. And then that unobstructed sight would be great for those squirrelier characters because, you know, maybe you're chasing somebody and they decide to hide in a bush. For that brief period, you could see them in the bush and deliver the killing blow to give your teammate just that little extra advantage because you're gone.
And does this work on stealthed characters too?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. So that's the bane of my existence right there. Samuro is running away from you, and you're just about to land that final blow, and he goes invis, and you just can't see, and maybe he jukes you and goes a different direction, and the Ravenlord would be able to help you out with that.
Exactly. And it's nice, too, for those players that can't see that shimmer as well as other people. Because if you can see the shimmer, those invisible characters aren't too bad, but for those of us that have a hard time spotting the Nova that's running around invisibly, whew, that would be nice to be able to see her.
Absolutely, and I'm sure they would hate that totally if you're playing a stealthy and you just can't get away, as long as the Ravenlord's on point. What were you thinking for your second basic?
The second one is called Sacred Ground. Now, the ground below the target-friendly hero is now blessed by the Ravenlord. This means two things. First, friendly heroes that walk on this area are blessed with a buff that increases their ability and attack damage for a period of time. This blessing will wear off if they step out of the area, but if they step back onto it, they're once again blessed. Secondly, the Ravenlord's E, which we'll get to, can now be used here for the remainder of the game.
Okay, so the sacred ground, does that sacred ground last the entire game, or is that ground going to just be an area to use your third basic later in the game and only have sacred ground on it for a specific amount of time?
This is a question I've played with, and I don't know if I came up with a good answer, because I like Chromie's slowing sands and the fact that you can leave it. Even though it drains your mana ever so slowly, you can leave it for extended periods of time in one area to give you sight while you're somewhere else with your team. So I think deep down I want to go with that. I want a circle you can lay down and you can leave it there if you want, or you can move it based on where the fights are breaking out.
So if a character is in the sacred ground and you put your Q, Lord's Blessing, on them, they're gaining both of these buffs.
Correct.
Ooh, that's cool. I like that because when you're battling here with that XP factor in mind where people have to stay alive because it's worth more XP to kill a hero, that's something that you don't want to mess around with.
Exactly, but you still, so you give them, they're worth more XP, but in order to balance that out, of course, you need to make them stronger so that they're actually worth the XP if they go down.
Oh, so cool. What were you thinking for the third basic?
Okay, E is territorial expansion. Now, able to slightly control the battlefield, the Ravenlord can open up a portal from the Nexus base to a selected area that has been used as sacred ground at least once before in the game.
Oh, I love that. That's huge movement. I mean, huge, huge. So is there a range limit to how far it can go, or is it basically like a medevac dropship? You can drop it down and it can go as long as you have sight.
Basically, and you don't even need sight. As long as a ground has been marked as that sacred ground once, doesn't matter if anyone's staying there anymore or you've moved the spell, it can still open up as a portal. And I like to think of it as a reward for the team having been able to push that deep or gotten to that position.
Yeah, I like that a lot. And repositioning, and you know, if your team gets wiped out or has to hearth and go back to the Hall of Storms back there, you can kind of reposition. So this has to be on a pretty lengthy cooldown, are you thinking? Because that can be really powerful if you're able to change it often.
Definitely. It would be a much longer cooldown than either Q and W. But I don't want it to be too limited, because again, you have only four people. So you need to make sure those four people are buffed enough to sort of match the five-person enemy team with the gifts you are giving them.
Great. So Trappy in the chat room is asking if it takes time to enter the portals or if they're instant. Do you just walk straight through them and you're teleported, or does it take a second to channel and transport you to the other side?
I imagine it would be a channel, very much like the well in Towers of Doom.
So cool. I love that. Very, very powerful. And your point to where you have to make these things powerful because you're taking a hero off the battlefield is well said. Let's get into the best part of this build. Let's talk about some heroics. What were you thinking there for your first heroic?
All right, well, you can't build the Raven Lord without the curse of the Raven Lord.
Absolutely.
Okay, so this one's a bit different, though. So you activate it, and when it's activated, whatever tower or towers or structures are being fought by your team, those then do not attack your teammates. However, they will still fire on minions. Structures, though, will attack heroes until those structures are damaged by the hero. So you can't run up to it and it stops attacking you. You have to hit it so it realizes it's taking damage from a hero and then stops attacking.
So this is basically a modified curse of what you would get in the Cursed Hollow battlefield.
Exactly.
So what you're saying, just for my own mind to clarify it, is if there's a tower, let's say you have a minion wave that's pushing a gate, and there's two towers attacking there, and you have two heroes coming up, it would benefit those two heroes to each go to one of the two towers each so that they can get a hit on each one of them, and then they would be cursed by this heroic.
Correct.
And it doesn't, so it's a global thing for the Raven Lord. He would just activate it, and that would be the case for the whole battlefield.
Correct. So wherever one of your teammates hits, it's turned off now.
That's really cool. I like that a lot. And I think that it kind of mitigates that whole OP section in a way, because if you were to just give the team a curse, which is something that is definitely on the minds of people when they think of the Raven Lord. I mean, it's what we know, is this gathering these tributes to get these curses, which are really powerful map objectives that basically do the same thing as your heroic, but on a more, you know, outstanding level than this. I think you did a really good job, and that was something that I struggled with building too, to create something like this. And I think yours, it trumps it. That's a really cool idea that you have to hit that tower in order for it to stop.
Definitely. And I also wanted to, again, taking in mind that you're missing a body, so maybe people won't feel forced to take a specific specialist, Sylvanas, for instance, to lock down the towers, because specialists, while great, a lot of them lack damage. So why not invest in another assassin versus trying to make up for a missing specialist?
Yeah, and you know what I'm thinking is a really cool idea here, that maybe you could talent into this heroic if you chose it later in the game to somehow affect mercenary camps too, to kind of fill that specialist role on your team, as you brought up Sylvanas.
That would be pretty nice, yes. But I mean, mercenaries are a huge part of it.
That's really cool. Okay, what's your second heroic?
All right, second I'm calling Manifest Destiny. Now, the time has come to take the map by storm and push the edge which rightfully belongs to the Raven Lord and his team. When activated, all areas that have been activated as sacred ground open up as portals. These portals are all connected, allowing teammates to dive in and out at will, causing nothing short of chaos on the map.
Oh, chaos is the perfect word. Oh man, that is powerful. So you're saying they go into these portals, and are they going to come out at a random one, or does it go in a clockwise order, or is it just, how does it work?
Nope, I imagine they jump in, and then they choose which one they come out of.
Oh, that's really cool. Talk about that coordination that we were talking about at the beginning of the show, where you'd have to choose where you're going to pop out of together to take a merc camp. And then once this is activated again, you could jump back in those portals and maybe head back to the Hall of Storms to Hearth. Ooh, this is like a stim drone on crack here. I mean, this is really intense.
Exactly. A team-wide Nidus network, if you will. That's having been set up all game.
Oh, that is really neat. So the Ravenlord player has to kind of decide where they're going to be putting this sacred ground or your second basic ability all around the battlefield, and maybe putting it near mercenary camps or putting it near map objectives where they could spawn. That would be really powerful on his map, right?
Oh, definitely. And of course, too, you'd have to think of the coordination you would even need with your team, right? Because you would probably play this hero a lot, so you'd know the exact places you'd want to put the sacred ground. So then you'd have to coordinate with at least one team member and be like, all right, I need you to get here. Just get there for me once and we're good.
That's great. Oh, this build is really, really great. I mean, with the whole thing, using the blessings and the sacred ground, and then being able to use that really cool adaptation of the Ravenlord's curse, and then, of course, this portal talk of jumping all over the battlefield, that really is map control to a T right there, being able to move wherever you need to be on points. So, Kristen, if you had to sum your build up altogether, what would you say this Ravenlord build is?
I would say it's called This Land Is My Land, Not Your Land.
Well said. This land is my land. All right, that's going to be tough to beat. I've got a large challenge ahead of us. But before we get to my build, I want to really reach out and thank all of our supporters. All of our supporters on patreon.com/heroesforge, where you too can support the show if you love it. Thank you to our patrons over there. We couldn't do the show without you, and it keeps us going week after week. So thank you. Thank you. If you'd like to support the show, you can head on over to that website. That's patreon.com/heroesforge. And also thank you to everyone that's given us a 5-star review on iTunes. If you enjoy the show and you listen to it on iTunes, head on over there and give us a 5-star review. It helps the show grow. And of course, we're on all of your favorite podcasting apps as well if you don't listen to us on iTunes. All right, let's get to it. Let's get to my build of the Ravenlord over here. I went with the specialist as well, Kristen.
Not surprising. And I don't know why it's not surprising. Maybe because we don't know what he looks like, right? So we don't know specifically what he would fit based on looks alone, only voice.
Yeah, so that's interesting that you bring that up. It's really cool that, you know, we both thought specialist. Mine's more of a true specialist than your build is, more of like a hybrid specialist that can do a bunch of cool stuff, including support. Mine's more of a specialist that you would think would be doing specialist-y things on the battlefield. So let's get into it. Let's get into my trade. I'm calling it Merciless Sun. So, in the realm of the Raven Court, the Raven Lord is said to control the world's merciless sun. The sun beats down upon the realm until the Raven Lord releases the powers of darkness upon the enemy, affecting not only their morale, but also releasing the powers of the undead upon them. When the battle begins, the Raven Lord player will have the ability to control vision on the battlefield. This is represented by a beam of sun that is set on patrol on the battlefield. The patrol has a set length, and the player will activate their trait to set the starting point and the end point of this sunbeam. Positioning of the sun will be key when playing the Ravenlord. The slow-moving beam reveals an area similar to the size of a Lunara Wisp, but unlike the Wisp, it cannot be destroyed. The fantasy here is that the Ravenlord will be able to extort his use of the Merciless Sun to aid his team in destroying his enemy and taking more realms in his name.
Nice. So this is a global?
Absolutely. So this is a global attack. or a global trait, I should say, and it's just these beams of sun that are coming down that give vision of specific areas, and it can go anywhere on the battlefield. But what I mean by patrol, it's similar to if you set a patrol in a real-time strategy game where you have an endpoint and a start point, the sun will have a designated length that it must travel. You can't control the length of it, so you can't have it sitting in one area. It has to be moving, and you just basically activate your trait to pick the starting point and activate it again to pick the ending point, and until you move it again, that's where it will be patrolling to.
Oh, what? So until you move it again, so it keeps patrolling the area you set up then?
Yeah, it's going back and forth from point A to point B, from point A to point B, and then you can set it to move, and then it would move to point A, and then from point A to the new point B, back and forth, back and forth.
I love that idea. It very much reminds me of the eye on the tower.
Yeah, Sauron.
Watching down for the ring.
Yeah, so that's kind of what I was going for, that feeling there. And now I delve a little bit more into what I think the character would be. So the Raven Lord would have two forms. It would actually have a tune on the battlefield, and his humanoid form would have him on foot and dressed as a vampire count. He'd have bleached white skin, a high collar, and a long sword in one hand with a blood-filled chalice in the other. When mounted, the Raven Lord would take on the form of a large raven, bigger than Medivh's raven, and move at a mounted speed. The Raven Lord would have a unique basic attack rotation. It would be comprised of two melee attacks, followed by one ranged spellcast basic ability.
Nice. So what do you think that ranged spellcast basic would look like?
I don't know. Maybe he's just like throwing some sort of poison, or maybe he uses the chalice in a way to kind of like splash blood as a basic attack as it's going through. But I thought that'd be a really unique idea, where the Raven Lord is able to kind of take up this huge sword in his hand, swing it twice, and then do a ranged attack, swing it twice again and do a ranged attack. So if the character went out of range for that ranged attack, it would still land, but you'd still be able to hit that ranged attack if you were in melee range.
Definitely. And I love the idea of him, because he sounds like a pompous
yeah.
Man. That's the way he talks anyway to me, of him just using the chalice to splash wine on somebody's face. Because what more of an insult could that be to somebody except to splash wine or blood in their face?
Yeah, probably blood. You know, that brings up a good point. In researching the Raven Lord, there's not a whole lot of backstory to what's going on all these wikis that you can check out. But when you go into the Raven Court wikis, which are the battlefield that all takes place on, or the realm, I should say, that it all takes place on, there's a little bit more lore about what's going on these battlefields. And, you know, these vampires are roaming around and the people are all poor that live there, and the Raven Lord's extorting them, and all of this is going on. And it's crazy. You should all check it out, because the lore is so cool to know about. And then when you go and you play the game, like I did today after doing these builds last week, and you go and you see these little things in there, it makes it that much better.
Well, one of the things I never realized was that there were two different voices in Towers of Doom. I thought it was just somebody having a crazy conversation with himself. But it turns out the Grave Lord is different from the Raven Lord, or the Gravekeeper is different from the Raven Lord, and there's actually a conversation going on in that mouth.
You know, that brings up a good point, though. What if it is just one person? What if it's Jekyll and Hyde, and you just don't know? Because that portal in the middle in Towers of Doom that opens up, it opens up for everyone at the same time. So when the Gravekeeper opens up that portal and says, I've opened this portal, and the Raven Lord says, well, I'm going to do that too, and then opens the portal, it's already open. So it could be the same person.
That's a fantastic idea. And I mean, going off of that, Haunted Mines, though owned by the Raven Lord, was voiced by the Gravekeeper. So how do we explain that?
I don't know. This is crazy. I'm telling you, that's the secret. It's going to come out, and he's going to be a character that at 10 you can choose if you want to be the Raven Lord or the... It'll be like your build, and then you can actually get a tune at 10, and you choose if you want the Raven Lord or the Gravekeeper. Anyway, we digress. Let's get into my basic abilities here. So my first one is called Bite, because I do imagine that he would be a vampire. So this short range melee attack is activated When it's activated, the Ravenlord will be able to bite the enemy and deal a small amount of damage to them. Unfortunately, this bite is infectious and will give the enemy unit hit with it a debuff called Cursed. Cursed players will have a curse placed on them for a short amount of time, and if they're in the light of the merciless sun, they will also take ticking damage until they either leave the sun, the debuff falls off, or they're eliminated. This ability can be used on any enemy unit in the game, not including structures.
The vampire lore in this is amazing. I love vampires. I love them. I even watched those new Dracula Untold movies. I love vampires so much. So this idea that you can curse somebody with a short vampirism that would then cause them to be damaged by sunlight is fantastic. Now, if they die in the sunlight, would they just crumble to dust?
Yeah, that'd be so cool. Or maybe if they die in the sunlight, there could be some sort of like crumbling and also like a reaching up towards the sun kind of animation that the character would have to do as they were turning into dust.
Yes. Now, in this case, would you want to make sure your light is always placed nearby where you think a battle would happen? Or would you kind of play with it? I'm based on the situation of the game at the moment.
Yeah, I'm thinking that that's a really good point. Based on the situation of the game and moving into more basic abilities, you'll see what I'm thinking. But you want it to be around where you are, but sometimes maybe not. I mean, there's some cool stuff coming. So let's get into it then. Let's talk about the second basic ability here. It's called Drawn to the Light. So the Ravenlord has one skill shot, and this is it. He uses his supreme magical powers, you can tell I used a thesaurus on this, to summon a purple orb that if it hits an enemy hero or a mercenary, it will grab them and drag them towards the light of the merciless sun. The drag will only last for a short amount of time and it won't take them all the way to the light, but it'll help the Ravenlord player place heroes in the sun if the sun is within range. Of course, this can be talented into later in the game to allow the orb to deal damage and drag enemies further towards the sun.
Gotcha. Now, if they hit the light, would it then keep them trapped within the light for a short period of time?
Ooh, that's a really cool idea too. I mean, I'm imagining the wombo combo here, where you come up and you bite them, and then they're trying to run away, and you throw the skill shot at them, and you draw them to the light, and they kind of move towards the light as they're, you know, got this, as you called it, short-term vampirism, and they're being dragged towards the light.
Oh my goodness. Oh, and could you imagine too, if they were grabbed so much as hypnotized, you know, like in Little Mermaid when Prince Eric is listening to Vanessa play the flute and he gets the gold in his eyes because he's been hypnotized by the music. Oh. You know, they kind of glow purple or something and they slowly move toward the light regardless of their will.
Yeah, and you know, vampire stories always have this sort of like romance built into it, right? So maybe they're falling in love with it. Maybe they have to go there like a bug zapper and they're just drawn to it. I love your idea of being hypnotized, and maybe we add this, that like the little falling in love aspect to it where they're just that romance entrancing them to go into the light. And then little do they know, once they get there, they take damage and burn up into a crisp.
Oh, I love it. And then, of course, you could play it, too, that as soon as they reach the light and they take damage, they're snapped out of it because pain hurts them enough to break the hold this light has over their will.
Really cool. Really cool idea, Kristen. I love that. So neat. Okay, let's get to the third basic. It's called Cursed. So the Ravenlord's known for his curses, and we all know that. When this is activated, the merciless sun sets, and for a very short amount of time, the sun becomes the unyielding moonlight. The enemies in this area are unable to attack the Ravenlord. The ability works on enemy units, including structures, and only lasts for a short amount of time. If the Ravenlord uses an ability that casts the merciless sun, or uses the sun, the timer will run out, and this ability will be canceled. So basically what this is an escape for the Ravenlord. If they're inside the sun fighting, they can switch it over to the unyielding moonlight. The enemy heroes, mercs, mercenary structures, everything can attack everything else, but they just can't attack the Raven Lord.
Gotcha. So they can't, I'm assuming then at that point they can't even target him, because that would I guess would just get messy. If you can't attack him but you could still target him, that would just get messy.
Yeah, and you've got to picture it, like, as soon as he stepped out of this unyielding moonlight, he would be targetable again. So maybe the strat there is to stay in the moonlight for the duration of this short timer until it rolls back over into the sun, waiting for your enemy teams, doing things, and you could probably talent into the moonlight later in the game to cause it to maybe spawn some sort of, you know, little minions that come up from the ground or something very vampire-y or something, or undead-like. So, yeah.
Yeah. So, would you still be able to bite them?
Yeah, you'd still be able to do everything that you could do previously. So, you could do all the biting, and you could do everything as you go through, but the sunlight, you wouldn't get any benefits of the sunlight.
No, but you could trick people into coming after you, surrounding you in a way, right? Mark every single one of them and then flip on that switch, and suddenly there's sunlight and it's hurting them and ticking them for damage that maybe they weren't ready to take because your basic attacks had whittled down their health.
Nice. That's the offensive way. That's really offensive, where the opposite spectrum would just be using it to escape if you needed to and you happened to be in the sun, and then just let it set and be moonlight, and then you could get out of there, which is where the normal escape abilities usually land, or huge movement abilities, is on that E key. So that's where it came from. But that offensive way is really cool. Go around and bite them all and they're all infected, and then flip it back over.
Yep, and then you curse one of them, the one with the lowest health, to pull into the sunlight, and boom, maybe you have a kill when they thought they were going to kill you.
And chat room is, Von Doom in the chat room is saying, one kill, ha ha ha, two kills, ha ha ha. Speaking of kills, let's get into some heroics here. The first heroic is called Relentless. So if this heroic is activated, the area of the merciless sun will blind all of the enemy players in the area. And now, a different kind of blind here. We're talking about their screens would have a burned-in image of what they were looking at when the ability was activated. This image will slowly fade back to their true view, but allow the friendly team to push forward during this time and confuse the enemy team.
And we know Blizzard's willing to do this. I mean, look at Dahaka when he puts that little hat on you, how limited your vision becomes. And then you got to kind of play by memory because you hope your team's around you. That's where they were a few seconds ago. Oh, how rough this would be, because then you'd probably have to try to move too. Or maybe the strategy would be just stand still and hold your ground.
Or spam all your abilities, throw your heroics down, and just try to get out of there, or, you know, kind of guess where you were at. And you know that feeling when you look in, or you even when a picture is taken and you got, you know, you can see what the picture was taken of, and you kind of look it around until you shake it off. That would kind of be this merciless sun aspect. But as the Raven Lord player, you'd have to have the sun in a position inside of a team fight where you could lock in the most players to get them all confused.
That's a good point. And I mean, you'd have to have a team that could lure the enemy team into the sunlight, because they would know. They could look at your talents and see which heroic you've chosen. It wouldn't be a secret. But would players who are bitten, who are cursed, take more damage or take a special kind of damage?
I don't think so. I don't want to make it super OP. They're still going to take the sunlight damage. This is just basically going to be a blast of light to everyone's eyes, like a camera flash. So I don't think, maybe you could talent into that. I'm building a whole bunch of talents here, but I think you could talent into that at some point to maybe do some serious damage to those people that are infected.
Totally. Oh, and I just had an idea. What if you had a team that was so good they could herd the enemy team away from where the sun is, you know, so the enemy team is lulled into a false sense of security. And then, boom, your Raven Lord allocates a new thing directly on top of the enemy team of sunlight, and then immediately hits that heroic as soon as the light hits the ground.
Yeah, and then everybody goes to town with heroics, everything going off. Ravenlord's running around biting people, doing his two melees and his ranged attack. It's crazy.
Somebody gets a spray bottle. No, Ravenlord, no. Down.
Well, if you're thinking about a spray bottle already, wait till you hear this second heroic. It's called Coffin. So it's a crazy idea. When this is activated, the Ravenlord selects a player to place in a coffin. This player is locked in the coffin and is unable to escape its dark reaches. Once the player is placed in this coffin, a Ravenlord tribute spawns near an enemy hero. A member of the enemy team will need to channel this tribute in order for the trapped player to be released. The channel time would be much shorter than a tribute capture on, like, Cursed Hollow, so to speak. But this ability would be similar to a Anubarak's web wrap, but instead of having the enemy destroy the web wrap to get their hero out, the enemy team would need to channel the tribute to get them out. So it can be talented into later in the game for the coffin to deal damage to the player that's trapped inside, and I would call that talent nails in the coffin.
Nice, nice. Now, the tribute, would it spawn right near the person in the coffin or near just a random enemy hero?
It would spawn near a random enemy hero, I think. That way, they would have to stop whatever they're doing, turn, and choose to channel this tribute to get their friend out. And as we've seen with the Anubarak web wrap, that doesn't always go over so well when, you know, Vala, your main damage dealer, is stuck in this cocoon and nobody's getting her out.
No, no. Instead, they're backing up, and then you're in the cocoon, and then you're surrounded by the enemy team, and it's lights out. And but that being said, we also now have Varian's buff, his flag, and people do a generally good job, better job of targeting that thing.
Yeah, and the puffer fish, right?
Yeah, exactly. There's hope out there, I think, little by little.
Absolutely, but this is, again, one of those abilities I really like where it would force the enemy team to stop what they were doing and do something else and possibly give the advantage to your team while you're fighting, while they're channeling that tribute. Maybe that's just enough time to lock them down. They're obviously already 4v5 in this team fight, so if you lock another one of them down and take them out, and then somebody else has to get to that tribute, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah, now with the tribute too, that would be a channel, so that would be completely interruptible all the time, right?
I think so, yeah, but it would be much shorter than like a tribute channel, maybe half as long, where you just have to stand there, kind of, then they're free, rather than, you know, giving you the really long timer to be able to interrupt it.
Oh, gotcha. That would still be frustrating, though, but only if it showed up during a team fight, you know, because then you're close enough to keep the interrupts coming, and that forces the enemy team to either fight 4v5 or to just back up and say, good job, friend. We'll see you on the other side.
Half the work's done already. They're already in the coffin. I mean, so yeah, it'd be on a timer too. So they'd come out of it if that happened, and then they'd definitely be taken out by the friendly team if they were still around that coffin. Okay, that's my build. That's my Ravenlord, who I turned into a vampire count, who comes down here and he's got this merciless sun. So if I had to sum it all up, I'd say that he uses this merciless sun to extort the battlefield and use it against the enemy team.
I like it. He uses that which he hates to destroy his enemies. It's poetic.
it very much is. And maybe, what if he... Well, you know, some vampires, right, they don't, in some vampire lore, they don't actually get hurt when they're in the sun.
Correct. I mean, even Dracula was so old, it just didn't bother him anymore. They had to kill him with the stake in the heart. They couldn't do it in the daytime. I mean, he walks around in the daytime once he starts getting his powers regenerated.
Yeah, so that would be the lore here that we would add for the Ravenlord, is that he is a vampire, but he could go into his own merciless sun that he was controlling and it wouldn't affect him.
Exactly. He's so old and so powerful, he can laugh at that now.
And with his really maniacal laugh as he laughs in Cursed Hollow. All right, those are the two builds. But before we call these heroes forged, we got to get into the crazy stuff. We got to start talking about specialty skins. Kristen, what is the... Did you have a specialty skin for yours?
It's more of a specialty overlay, and I'm calling it Through the Eyes of a Lord. And instead of the usual overlay, it's now made to look like it's been constructed as part of a lavish Gothic estate. And then all of the colored portions, like the ability pictures and the mini-map, are now designed to look like they're stained glass.
Cool. So is it just the... That's a really cool stained glass. I love that. Is that the... Just the Ravenlord is seeing this, or are the other characters that you're playing with seeing a change in their overlay too?
That's a good question. I want to say just the Ravenlord player, just to keep it special for that player. And then it wouldn't be too distract, because I wouldn't personally want that as another player, because it might be too distracting, too weird, and, you know, kind of throw off my game.
Yeah, that's really cool, though. And again, we know they're not afraid to do stuff like that, because when you jump in Morales' medevac dropship, it changes with whatever skin she's wearing, which I think is really neat.
Mm-hmm. And then when you get eaten by stitches.
Yeah, that's another good one. Oh, yeah. Oh, I hate getting eaten by stitches, because usually he takes you to a place that you don't want to be.
Well, that's what Stitches was created for.
I know. You play Stitches a lot, don't you?
I do. I love Stitches. He's disgustingly amazing. Just disgusting. And of course, with bikini Stitches, how can you not? How can you not play him?
Yeah, and when we had the opportunity to tour the Blizzard campus during BlizzCon, they had the bikini Stitches concept art, basically. Why don't you tell everybody about that?
Oh, it's just a little sticky note, just a little yellow sticky note that I believe it was Samwise sketched a really simple bikini Stitches on, and the team went with it, and the rest is history.
The rest is the future, I think. The rest is the future. Yeah, it was really cool. Just that little sticky note that they drew it on there. My specialty skin is less intense. I mean, it's pretty cool, though. It's Lestat. Just a Lestat skin, which would change him into... Because, you know, when I think of Lestat, I think of Interview with the Vampire. So...
Yes.
You know how Lestat is immortal, so goes through all the time periods that Lestat goes through. So those would be the color variations. So you could choose that you were, you know, this Victorian and then moving into, you know, the U.S. Revolution maybe, and then pass that into modern day Lestat with like a tuxedo or some sort of suit on.
I love it. Now, would you also get a chance to do the decrepit looking Lestat, the one that's been feeding on frogs and creatures of the swamp?
Oh, maybe that's the basic one. Maybe that's the one that you get at the start and then you got to work up towards, or maybe it's the last one and you just let it decay into that.
Oh, it would be incredible either way. I mean, Tom Cruise's Lestat. Listeners, if you have never watched Interview with the Vampire, watch Interview with the Vampire. It is engrossing, it's intriguing, it is a very, very good vampire movie. Probably one of the best, if not the best.
Yeah, I'm not into vampire movies, and I like that film. It does have a definite cult following to it. I mean, a lot of people like it just because other people like it, but I think it's actually pretty entertaining.
It does. It tells a decent story, and if you can get past Brad Pitt's character, who's kind of a downer a lot of the time, it's really worth it. Tom Cruise's performance as Lestat is absolutely worth watching.
Yeah, and Chatroom is saying that there's even an Interview with the Vampire book, which I didn't know, which maybe I'll have to pick up and read.
Yep, it's by Anne Rice, and it's a chronicle series, actually. Queen of the Damned is a part of that. Not that you should watch Queen of the Damned, but the book is also really, really good. And it gives you a richer backstory. But if we're talking about really good book to movie translations, Interview with a Vampire is really good. It holds up.
Oh, I'll have to check it out. All right, so let's get to the last part of these builds here, which is the dance moves and what dance they would do in the Nexus. If you typed /dance on my Ravenlord build, he would summon a ghost and ballroom waltz with them.
First time I snuck a read before we started, and when I read that, I thought the ghost waltzers at Disney in the Haunted Mansion.
Yeah, exactly like that. And, you know, this ghost, you type /dance, press enter, this ghost would just appear from the ground, come up, he'd assume the waltzing position with them, and then just do a little 1-2-3 circle, and then the ghost would go back down, and he'd just be his regal, you know. It takes a lot of talent to waltz with a chalice full of blood and a longsword.
It does, but he can do. I mean, he's a vampire lord after all. And wouldn't it be cool too if he did it and some ghostly string music you could hear playing in the background?
Oh, it'd be great. It'd be great. What were you thinking for your, I mean, your dance is difficult because you don't really have a tune on the battlefield. So what were you thinking?
No, not at all. But this, I thought, I called it shake your tail feathers. And birds land, and then they shake their little tail feathers at the camera.
Ravens, right? Are we thinking ravens here?
Yeah, it would have to be ravens. But maybe there's a pigeon who gets in on it because pigeons are everywhere.
Absolutely. Why not a pigeon? Maybe it's like the cool Hearthstone board secrets where sometimes you can get a pigeon and you're like, I got the pigeon.
Well, there we go. There we go. And maybe that the weird bird that shows up changes every once in a while. So sometimes there's an angry chicken that shows up.
Bada bing, bada boom. With that, these heroes were forged. You know, it was really fun to bring a character into this that has just the tiniest bit of backstory that we've never seen before and try to make it something for Heroes of the Storm. It's also, it's exciting because they have somewhere to go with this. They have somewhere, and it's anywhere. It's really an infinite space for them to create this character.
It is. They've given us a name. They've actually given us a character. I mean, the voice actor does a great job giving us an idea of what this person is. And though we have bits of what the backstory may be, it's not enough to make it so rigid that they can't take it somewhere crazy in the future.
Yeah, it's inspiring to know that these characters are coming out. And, you know, when we have, I mean, even in the newest StarCraft maps, the one with the Zerg pushing, there's a guy in the background that's like testing this facility and he's talking to you. So that could be a character. Like there's a ton of stuff that they could do, and they're building this infrastructure of heroes lore that's just great.
And what's best about this one too is that even though this is a character with hardly anything in terms of story, there's enough there that we were able to debate and build this entire story between him and the Gravekeeper. We even were able to ask questions of potential relationships between the two and suggest something nuts that maybe they're the same person. And I don't think with characters that have had little backstory, we've ever been able to do that before.
No, it's really neat. It's really fun too. I mean, that's what makes this show fun, is to be able to kind of think outside the box or inside the box, as we said at the beginning, and come up with some really cool ideas. All right, those are two really cool specialist Raven Lord builds that you get to vote on. Again, you can vote on them on our Twitter page, which our Twitter handle is @ForgeHeroes. If you don't follow us on Twitter, what are you waiting for? Go on over there and hit that follow button, because every week we announce what hero we're going to be forging on Sunday nights. So check it out on our Twitter page, and we have some updates all week long about the happenings around the heroes world. Kristen, where can people find you in the interwebs?
People can find me at Dream Destroyer. That is DrmDestryr over at Twitch, Twitter, and YouTube, as well as my health and fitness blog, battletobebetter.weebly.com, where this week I go over what good cheat days or cheat meals are.
Oh, so like planning around, like, for example, if you're going to go to McDonald's, maybe not go crazy.
Exactly. The whole idea that cheat days have to be structured. They can't just be free-for-alls, because free-for-all cheat days actually end up hurting you usually far more than helping you.
Oh, gosh, I'll have to tune in. I love that kind of stuff, just to know how it affects your body. Because I hear some people talking about how maybe these people just want to go to Korean barbecue on their cheat day, but they say, you know, it could stimulate your metabolism or go through this stuff. I'm like, oh, it doesn't sound quite right.
No, and if it doesn't sound quite right, it's probably not right. But there's, as I've discovered through all of this, the way things are said and talked about, the language used often leads to lots of misunderstandings, and very innocent misunderstandings that lead to those rumors, like starvation mode or keeping that metabolism hot kind of thing.
Yeah. I'll have to check that out. Everybody check out Battle to Be Better. Kristen does great work over there. If you want to find me, I'm right here on Heroes Forge. We record every Sunday night at 7 p.m. Pacific on twitch.tv/amovetv because we are a very, very, very proud part of the Amove TV podcast and entertainment network. For more great esports and video game podcasts, head over there. Check out The Gamers Inn, a show I recently started watching and fell in love with. It's great. The personalities are great. The information is great. There's tons of great stuff over there. Check out amove.tv for more. You can find us again on Twitter at ForgeHeroes, on YouTube at youtube.com/HeroesForge, and on our website where we got 47 other hero characters that we've built at It's heroesforge.club. I'm getting ahead of myself here because the website that you can contact us on, if you have an idea for a build for a character you'd like to see on this show, send us an email to contactheroesforge@gmail.com or head on over to our website, which again is heroesforge.club. Click on the contact tab and it'll send you to a page that you can send us a direct message. We like to respond to as many of the messages as we can and get to as many of the builds as we can. We have lots of stuff coming in, so if you're still waiting for a response, it's on the way. I promise we're getting to it. Lots of great stuff to read, and you guys are amazing. Again, if you'd like to support the show, you can head on over to patreon.com/heroesforge and throw us a buck or two to help keep the show going. And a huge thank you again to all of our patrons, Kristen. They are rock stars.
They are the top rock stars. They are Lestat rock stars. They are the ones that would dare defy the social order in order to have that thrill of life through creating heroes in Heroes Forge.
I'm not sure I would put Lestat and the thrill of life together. I mean, I think he's lacking the thrill of life, right?
Oh, dude, you have no idea. The book series at one point, He wakes up the queen of the vampires, who is created back in ancient Egyptian days, right? She's old. And he wakes her up because he decides to become a rock star. And so when he's a rock star, he'll touch the hands of people in the audience. And he sings about being a vampire. And so it talks about how when the girls touch his ice cold hands, they realize they know he's an actual vampire in that moment.
I have to read that. It sounds really entertaining.
It's all a guilty pleasure.
I gotta check it out. Seriously, it sounds great. All right, everybody, we're gonna call the show there. I'm Jeff. As always, this is Kristen, the awesome co-host of the show. You guys were rock stars, and we will see you all in the real world.